Hello, everybody. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here. See quite a few familiar faces, and that's great. And I'll be really delighted to talk about the topic that you see on the screen. But before doing so, let me just express my gratitude to the Bühler family, to you, Calvin, and to you, Ian, where are you there, for a long time support of the activities of ETIA, of our joint mutual projects that we have. We appreciate it very much, and we feel honored and that we can work together with such an outstanding company. Thank you very much for that. Now, I will talk about energy, I will talk about education, I will try to give you some hints how we at ETIA try to solve is too big a word, how we try to address this very big issue of energy that Ian Roberts so well explained to us. I believe this is one of the two, three key questions that will decide about the survival of our species on this planet. If we cannot solve the energy quest, I'm not very confident that we'll be able to survive as a culture. Of course, the human race will be there, but I'm not sure we will have the same level of culture, of well-being, of living together than we would have if we solve this problem. It's a problem worthwhile working on. You know all these figures here, the upper curve shows you the energy consumption in various scenarios, the lower curve shows you the CO2 emission in various scenarios. Let me state that very clearly. Planet Earth has not an energy problem. Planet Earth has so much coal that we could live on for another 1,000 years with the known reserves. We have not an energy problem. We have a CO2 problem, or to be more precise, we have a CO2 absorption problem. If we continue to emit CO2 on the level that we did in the last years, you see we will reach unsustainable limits. We're emitting now in the order of 34 billion tons of CO2 every year. Forget about all these 350 ppm scenarios, forget about the 2-degree scenario that we're all hearing about. We need to work very, very hard to achieve these. We need to reduce substantially our CO2 emission, and the projections are that somewhere in this century we will have to reach zero CO2 emissions, a completely decarbonized energy and economy. This is a huge task. I have no idea how we can solve that. I have to tell you that very upfront. But I know we have to do it. And of course, we need the younger generation and the generation after that to do that. And what can I do as a president of a university? I try to educate these people, hoping that they are more clever than we were. Switzerland is flat. These are the CO2 emissions of Switzerland. Of course, you can now debate. The population of Switzerland has increased dramatically over the last 50 years. When I was born, Switzerland had 5 million inhabitants. Now we are more than 8 million. So you can say this is a success story. We have more people and emit still the same amount of CO2, roughly. Huh? But the story is not true. Because the same amount of CO2 that we emit in Switzerland is emitted outside of Switzerland to feed, to clothe, to make Switzerland a habitable place. So we produce the same amount of CO2 as we produce in-house, out of our house. And this is unfair to forget about that. In food, of course, it's all the feed that we need for produce all the meat inside the country. So we need to be very careful. It's very easy to tell lies with good-looking numbers by not telling the whole story. So we have to be very careful about that. What is our main mission? It is education, it is research, and it is tech transfer, as every good university does. Energy has always been one of the focus areas of ETIA. I don't want to go through all these examples. I'll show you a couple of examples later on, but just a few nice pictures. ETIA was created in 1855 with the clear mission to build up Switzerland. Switzerland was built 1848, the modern state. And one of the missions of ETIA was educate the engineering workforce that can build up the industry and the infrastructure of Switzerland. And of course, energy was part of it. So we have taken that very seriously. We have some 50 faculty members at ETIA who work on energy-related issues. I hired many of them in the last couple of years. We are leading seven of the major SCCRs, the CTI, KTI, Research Energy Centers. We are involved in all of what is going on in Switzerland in energy. And of course, when you talk about energy, it is clear that energy is an abstract thing that has to be linked with food, with climate, and particularly with cities. Most of you will know, but I'll repeat it nevertheless. The shift from the rural areas to the urban areas is inexorable. It does, you cannot stop it. I think we are already reached a point where more than 50% of the world's population lives in urban areas. Cities are the key issue. If we want to solve the energy issue, the food issue, etc., we need to have a solution for this global trend. Not just in the developed world, but also in the developing world, we can see this here. Food is, of course, the topic of this conference, of this gathering here. Achim Walter is a classical food professor, classical crop science professor, and he's telling that we need clearly digitalization of this process as well. So, of course, Ian, it's bringing coals to Newcastle to you, but the whole development into digitalization is one aspect, is one stepping stone into this solution. It's not the only one, but without it, I'm convinced we cannot do it. Let me give you an example. There is a big European project going on at ATR, precision farming. You see here the partner. The idea is that with drones, everybody talks about drones, of course, this is one of the killer apps. With robots, you try to avoid, for instance, to use a lot of pesticides, or you try to get better information. Sorry for that, excuse me. Can I skip back? Yes. What you see here is our big research facility we have together with the University of Zurich in Lindau, Eschiken. We're building up a new system, but we have already some going on there. And we have four of these poles that carry one of these cameras. It's not just the camera, there are many other sensors on this device here, soil moisture, composition, etc. And we oversee a very large field, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, and we really observe how this crop is growing. We see fungus problems, we see water, moisture problems, we see all the vegetation dynamics, the kinetics of all these reactions. And of course, this is then a very expensive installation that we have there. It could not be transported to a general field, but with these drones that will then carry, you see the poles in the back. So this is then the transfer of this technology to a product, could be sold by one of you, that will be enabled then to make this precision farming. Waste no pesticides, waste no fertilizers, waste no water. You heard about the important role of water in food. We need to become much more efficient, and digitalization can help us in this. Cities, we have two campuses in Zurich, by the way. We have one campus, a smaller one in Basel, and our international campus is in Singapore. More than 50 PhD students, more than 10 faculty members. We study their future cities. We have a future city laboratory since 2010 where we try to make an experiment in this environment, which is very, very urban. I know of no more urbanized regional zone than Singapore. It's a city state. And I'll show you one very nice example that came out of this research. It's called the 342 project. What is this? Now, look on the left side. That's how you typically build high rises everywhere worldwide, but particularly in hot and humid climate zones. You have the usable space, and then you have these intermittent floors where you bring in air. This air is used for ventilation, of course. You have to have fresh air. You get to get rid of the pollutants. But most importantly, the air is used to cool and to dehumidify. You have to take moisture out, and you have to take thermal energy out of the system. This is a very, very inefficient way of doing it. You use a lot of space, very valuable space. Now, our people in Singapore came up with the idea of separating these three things: the ventilation, change the air, get rid of the pollutants, the cooling, and the dehumidification, by bringing in the energy that is needed for ventilation, for the air conditioning and the dehumidification, not by air, but by water. Simple idea, but you know that 1 cubic meter of air is more or less 1 kilogram. One cubic meter of water is more or less 1,000 kilograms. That means, roughly speaking, forget about the thermodynamic details, you can bring in 1,000 times more energy with one cubic meter of water than you can do with one cubic meter of air. And if you can bring in 1,000 times more energy, that means you can reduce the diameter, the space, by everything, by a factor of 1,000. It's a simple idea, and love simple ideas. You know, the real breakthroughs are always very simple. And by doing that, what do you achieve? You achieve, first of all, an energy saving. I'll show you that in a minute, because you're much more efficient. You don't need to move a lot amount of air. And second, more importantly, reduce the space so that you can fit in three floors in the height of two of the older building. And now this is a very interesting story, because I believe we can save only the planet Earth if it is a business case. We cannot save Earth by having subsidies, by having whatever good people wanting to do it. It must become a profit case. If there isn't a business case behind it, we won't be able to save the world. And this is my ambition. This is ETH's ambition, to make a green economy that is a profitable economy. I want to push up EBIT. That's my main importance. And I want, in the same time, to save the planet. I will never achieve it. But I want to inspire people to try to do that. And in this case, we succeeded. So we have 50% more floor space. Can you imagine how much that is valuable in Singapore? They have no land, poor guys. But we can give them 50% more floor space. They are very happy. And we have reduced the energy consumption dramatically. These are the 90% building. These are the median value of the building in Singapore. How much energy they consume. And look where we are. And look where we want to be in a few years. This is what I believe is a typical example which we should strive for. Another one. Don't take me wrong, but the last form of transportation which will be decarbonized is air flight. You need a lot of energy in very little mass and very little volume if you want to fly from Zurich to Singapore. You need to take that fuel with you. So forget about batteries, sorry to say that clearly. The last thing of transportation we will do electrically, I can bet you, is flying. Now, how can we then have a decarbonized air transportation? By the way, this is the fastest growing transportation sector. It is small yet, but if you look at the numbers, it's staggering, the growth rate that they have there. Everybody wants to fly, and everyone wants to fly more. Prices go down. So what can we do there? The idea is, of course, to use solar energy to produce jet fuel. And you can do that. Aldo Steinfeld has proven it in a big European project. He's now working on making it more efficient, more scaling it up. But essentially, by using solar energy and water and CO2 from the air, there is a spin-off of ETH who is able to collect CO2 from the air. You just reject the oxygen. You can use it maybe in food processing. You produce what is called syngas, H2 and CO. And with this, in a very well-known process, Fischer-Tropsch, the German, by the way, ran a world war on this Fischer-Tropsch process, you can produce liquid hydrocarbons. And liquid hydrocarbons are the best form to store energy. It's the cheapest, safest way for long-time energy storage. So we solve two problems. First of all, we solve this old dilemma. How do you store summer days? Today, we have a lot of energy from the sun, but we don't need it today. We need it in wintertime when the sun is not shining. How can we bring the energy from the summer, hot summer day into the cold winter night? You can do it by storing that energy in liquid hydrocarbons. But these liquid hydrocarbons must be CO2-free. How can you do this? Aldo Steinfeld has shown it to us. You see, technology is sometimes perceived as the problem creator. Completely wrong. Technology is the solution to the problem. Not only technology, but without technology, it won't work. Of course, we can't do this alone. We are working very closely with everybody all over the world. You see here our main partners. I'm sure that most of you are alumni or know these universities. We work very intensively also with industry. Bühler is one of the best examples we have. You know, of course, that Switzerland is one of these global competitive leaders in innovation, in competitiveness. I'm always very skeptical with these rankings. I don't believe in rankings, to be frank with you. But nevertheless, if you're on top of it, that's okay. If you're at the bottom, I'd completely ignore them. Luckily, we are never at the bottom. Now, what do we do at ETH? We have a Education, I believe, is the key to this. If you want to solve it, we need to better education. We have a three-tiered education level. It's an Anglo-Saxon approach, the undergrad, the graduate school in the master's and the doctoral program. The undergrad school is for Switzerland. It's taught in German. Most people who come in this undergrad program are Swiss students. We lose quite a bit, unfortunately. We are very tough. We have some 35% that we lose. We fill up the losses with people, talent from the outside. Then after the master, we lose a lot. For instance, to Bühler, that they go here and make decent, maybe even fantastic jobs. And we fill that up again with PhD students, doctoral students from outside of Switzerland. It is one of the key ingredients for a successful university, is openness, access to the global talent pool. I believe this is a non-negotiable condition. And we grew quite substantially over the last years, and that's good. The world can always need one engineer more. The world can always use one natural scientist more. There are never too many. We educate almost two-thirds of all mechanical and electrical engineers. We educate almost more than a third of all our civil engineers, mathematicians, physicists, sorry, and one-fourth of all natural scientists, in Switzerland, of course. What is important in education? Number one, the basics. We insist on the basics. Mathematics is our filter. We discriminate, we select our students based on math. Every department, every study program at ETH has mathematics as its core. And we insist on that, even if that causes a lot of problems to our students, even some people don't like it, that's the hurdle they have to jump over. For me, this is mathematics is distilled intelligence, and it's the only fair way to assess if somebody is really able to do later work that is based on logic or not. It sounds very harsh what I'm saying, I know that. But that's the summary of my lifetime. I'm close to 60, and I have to tell you, I have seen nothing better than that instrument to assess a person's ability to think logically. But of course, that's not enough. We insist very much on project-based learning. We believe that having hands-on experience is important, and I'll show you one of the best examples, Mirko Mebold, Roland Siegwart, and Markus Meyer. There's a long chain of faculty members at ETH who have worked on this. We have developed a whole suite of that. We call this innovation project. Every first-year student in mechanical engineering, and there are more than 500 who start every year at ETH, goes through this innovation project. What is this? They get a task. And that year, the task was rescue people from a burning high-rise building. So come up with an idea how you can go up 50 stories and take people out safely and bring them back. No ladder of a fire truck will go there, of course. How can we do that? And students had to come. These are the people, of course, that they rescue, the mechanisms. Yeah, far from perfect, of course. They have some experience. They know what goes. They know what doesn't go. It was not a harm to students. Don't worry. They succeed. They have fun. They learn how to work together in teams. They learn how to schedule a project, how to planify for it, how to keep on track on that. I tell you, this is a life-changing experience. These are kids out of high school. They have never touched a lathe, never touched a soldier iron, and they come up after that project and are really delighted. This is one thing that I believe is important to also give into a university education. Now, something that is very, very close to my heart is this initiative that I started personally. It's the Critical Thinking Initiative at ETH. I want to motivate it to you by something that most of you will have heard about. It's the Dieselgate scandal that happened many years ago. Dieselgate, for me, is something that I perceive as a very, very dangerous development. We need to educate people who are fantastic in the basics, who know how to handle projects, but also who have a character, who are able to think. Everybody's talking about internet and how great that is and how many opportunities this gives us. True. But I sometimes am a little bit afraid that people delegate the thinking to the internet. If you have a problem, ask Google. This is a dangerous development, ladies and gentlemen. We need to make sure that our people think by themselves, that they think creatively, that they're able to learn the basics, but also able to question the authorities. If we don't do that, we will not have true progress. We will run into problems like at Volkswagen. where the engineers did not stand up against the pressure from upper management to do something which was ethically not correct. We need people who know how to solve differential equation and people who are able to say no if some unethical things are going on. I try at ETH to combine these things. Energy is at the core of it. As I told you, we have four special master programs only on energy. The science in energy, science and technology, since 2007, way before Fukushima, we had a special effort here to enforce that. You see here the details. Many people from all over the world come and take this master's program, very successful, and bring this knowledge then into the next step. What we also do with a lot of energy, I hope also with a lot of success at ETH, is to foster entrepreneurship at our students. It starts with the PhD program. You have a big idea, you make a patent, and you participate in the Spark Award. If you win, you are automatically eligible for the Pioneer Fellowship, which is 150,000 Swiss francs, 1.5 year, lab space advice, where you can develop your idea, into a prototype and test if it really works. If it works, we then help our students to create their own spin-off company to realize the ideas. And there are many, as I told you before, for instance, Climeworks, who, for instance, takes out CO2 from the atmosphere, that have very successfully worked. You see our track record. Last year, we had a record of 25 spin-off companies created out of ETH. And these are the ones that are really created out of ETH. Many are somewhere else, which we don't control, but they went through our certification process. They raise money. They become rich. They are sold to Roche, Novartis, whatever. It's fine. It's great. Only if it makes business sense, we will be able to save the planet Earth. I want to show you one example which is relevant also to Bühler. There is a KTI, a CTI project running together with Bühler on this new technology about electrodes for batteries. Batteries are everywhere. Batteries will play a big role. They have had a huge success. But there is one problem. If you want to charge them fast means 30 minutes, by the way, yeah? Not 1 minute, compared to a slow charge, here you see an example of a lithium-ion battery, you degrade the capacity of the battery very quickly. So you see after some 500 charging and discharging cycles, you have less than 40% of the capacity. So the batteries can store much less energy than they did when they were new, because you ruined them by pushing and in electricity, energy, electric energy, in a very fast and very quick way. All sort of nasty processes happen, and thermal, kinetic happens, everything. Now, what does Batrion, what is the key idea of Batrion? If you look at today's batteries, there is one part of the battery, which is called the electrode, which is formed out of graphite. This is graphite, it's a microcut. And the lithium ions have to wander through this thing here. And you see here the boundaries of the grains. Your picture here is more a little bit more clear to understand. There is a lot of waste when we produce the graphite to make that substrate there. And second, by being round, you have a lot of detours. The process is not efficient. There's a long path that the ions have to go through. Now, Batrion came up with the idea, why don't we use these original flakes and order them? Of course, you ask me now, how do they do that? That's their intellectual property. It has to do with some magnetic processes. I can tell you not much more. But they have come up with an idea how to order this thing now. And now it's obvious what happens. You have a much shorter way. Path length going from one side to the other, where you then take up the electrodes. So you reduce the time that it needs to charge the battery. And by having this order, you also reduce all the bumping around. And so you it seems to work. You try also to reduce the degradation process that you see there. This now is, of course, that has a lot of to do with processing. So Bühler will play a big role, how to do that, scaling it up. And you see here an example how combining forces from academia and industry can really lead to new products that give a business opportunity and help save the world. This is the timeline, how this goes on, not so important. This is the last slide. I want to emphasize that we are very proud to be at the heart, not the only one. There are many other universities. Medical science is very important. There are what we call University of Applied Science, Fachhochschulen in German. There are many research centers here, IBM Research Center, for instance. Or you know that Google has its third largest research center of the world in Zurich. One is in Mountain View, second one is in New York, and number three is in Zurich, and they have unbelievable plans how to expand there. This has all happened not only because of ETH, but I would bet you without ETH it would not have happened. So it's not a sufficient condition, but it's a necessary condition. I read something very funny a few days ago. You know what the Love Parade is? This is 1 million people dancing along the streets of Zurich on one Saturday evening. And they told me that also the Love Parade is one of the reasons why Zurich is so successful with Google. They want to attract bright people, and bright people want to have fun in their life. So we need to combine that. Great fun, great science, great business opportunities. And that's what Zurich offers. And we're very proud of that, and I hope that I could convey a little bit of that enthusiasm to you. Looking forward to see you in Zurich, looking forward to maybe cooperating with you, and thanking you for your attention.